同地帯に性的虐待の過去があった船員がいたというショッキングな情報です。ニューヨークの世界本部で奉仕し、目覚めよしを執筆していた経験のある女性が組織の内部について語ります。この女性の名はバーバラ・アンダーソンさん。1992年に性的虐待の被害者を慰める目覚めよの記事が出たとき、ベテル内の兄弟姉妹たちは動揺しました。このエピソードでは、目覚めよしの編集者を長年務めたペロイアン兄弟が登場します。ペロイアン兄弟のライフストーリーは、2005年のまのみの投資で読むことができます。バーバラさんが組織内で直接見聞きしたことをインターネット放送で語ります。聞き手は3年前まで世界本部で奉仕していた兄弟です。彼は今は JW の活動を休止しています。
See, this is a very, this is a very wide-ranging, geographical audience.So we're glad to have everybody here. We have the entire United States looks like.
So he one day talked to me about child abuse, and he said that the problem was that, that too many men who were convicted molesters were in positions of authority in the organization because of repentance. Mm. And he even told me, he said, I don't like this word repentance.He said, I believe our organization doesn't understand the scriptural application, the true scriptural application of repentance. And they're putting men who are claiming to be repentant as elders and ministerial servants. And he said, they're molesting. An article came out in The Awake, and I will show you this one. October 8th, 1991, and we received it in our room. Bethelites received a few weeks before everybody else. So I read the article, and I thought it was very interesting. It was very long,、mm-hmm. Healing the Wounds of Child Abuse. So I thought that this was a problem that the Catholics were having. The child abuse was just beginning to rear its ugly head in the Catholic Church, specifically in Boston, Massachusetts, And so watching the world was always quoting some newspaper about child abuse. So I thought, well, this is a magazine for its most widely distributed magazine in the world at the time next to Reader's Digest. So I said, oh, this is for everyone else. Well, it wasn't. And it's after this. It was approximately two with this.But he was bothered by it because he had a personal, and his wife had personal friends that he was fine. At that time, he had found out that they had a history of being molested that they kept secret. When this article came out, it opened a Pandora's box. They had tens of thousands of letters.Coming into Bethel over this article, one, and these people were writing in about their abuse and saying that it was the Jehovah's Witnesses who molested them, and they thought it was a breath of fresh air the organization was addressing this.
Wow.
And it opened up this huge, awful situation because the service department and the writing department disagreed.And the writing department wanted to do something about this. The service department, they thought they were handling it. But what they were doing was talking to people over the phone, and especially circuit overseers about these issues, district overseers also. Mm-hmm. And the child abuse situation was becoming so profound in my life. All I could do was think about this and...As information was coming to me, and the discussions were daily with a very small group of people in the writing department, basically. Lloyd Berry, over the department, he knew about the issue. He was very well acquainted. He was a very smart man, actually. Mm. Had a lot of education, worldly education behind him anyway.
Okay.
Harry Poloyan that I was leaving Bethel, I also suggested that we needed to convince the governing body that we had a really serious problem. So he and I just, we brainstormed on it. And we discussed that the issue at the time was regarding repressed memories. After The Awake came out, so many people came forward, men and women, and said they remembered when they were abused. They had pushed it aside. Mm-hmm. And then in years later, after this, they were triggered. And they remembered what happened to them. And it was men in positions. It wasn't the rank and file Jehovah's Witnesses. It was men in positions that molested them. I have heard back in those years every kind of story you can imagine. So I was asked to do research on repressed memories. The governing body was being influenced by Ted Jarrus, who was a very powerful member of the governing body. Many of them called him the boss. And so he was saying that there wasn't any such thing as repressed memories. And so...
So Ted Jarrus, basically his assertion was that, like, for example, all of these letters that they received and all of that and all these accusations, that they basically just were products of people's perhaps subconscious reaction to what they, you know, read in the articles. It wasn't actually due to, because he basically, it sounds like he refused to believe that these things were actually happening, especially to that level of prevalence within the organization.
Absolutely.
Okay.
He was when he was the overseer of service. Mm-hmm. He was also the on the teaching committee.
Okay.
But writing department was separate, as service was separate from writing service. Okay. So then the key members of the teaching committee would be involved. Well, Jarrus was on that, and but he did not know that this article was coming out. And he was against it, we found, I was told. And so in time, April 8th of 92 was an article about thanking the governing body for this October issue. Letters were used, and it says a breath of fresh air. And this is what happened. Ted Jarrus found out that this article on the April 8th following year was coming out. He tried to stop the presses. He was dead set against it. And so when the report came in from the press room, whoever was overseer there, and to the writing department, Jack Barr, who was assistant, who had to make the decision. And he was a very wonderful man, I have to tell you. He was not of a strong personality, and he didn't know what to do. So he involved the senior writers, and they all told him that you can't allow this to happen. This isn't Jarrus's department. Mm-hmm. You can't allow him to what the writing department should print. And so he then made sure that the article went through. So that was very obvious what was happening with the Jarrus. We also had reports, and I was part of it happening almost every week. There was something big that was happening, the child abuse. Many of the elders who were very loving and kind, they were trying to set up classes, some actually did, to help victims of child abuse. Nice. And do it. And the attitude and some in the service department was that it was a fad. Child abuse was just a fad, and you can't believe this. You can't get on the bandwagon. The world is in this fad. And Barry, Lloyd Barry, many years before, he was the overseer of the Japanese branch. And it was, this was in the mid-50s. And Ted Jarris was the overseer of the Australian branch. Mm-hmm. And something happened with Ted Jarris, and he was removed from his position as overseer and moved to California, told to go to California. The accusations against him are not out there, but it was Knorr who had Lloyd Berry come from Japan to investigate, so Lloyd knew what it was, recommended his removal. In the years, many, many years later, I was informed that Ted Jarris was removed from molestation.
Ted Jarris of the governing body had been removed from the governing body? No, I'm sorry, from what position?
Branch overseer of Australia.
Oh, okay, okay.
Wow. That is a fact. But he married her right away. And then within 6 months, Norm put him into the special work. So they were into the circuit work and then into the branch district work. And from there, just before 72, I have the actual dates, and he was called in to be a governing body member at the time. And so I cannot understand what happened, why. He was never claimed to be one of the anointed, and all of a sudden he becomes one of the anointed at the end of the 60s.
We'd been told we'd find a member of the governing body here. Ted Jarris is one of the men responsible for the church's child protection policy. For more than 2 months, we've been asking them for an interview. We want answers to some simple questions. Why do they keep their database of suspected paedophiles secret? Why don't they report all allegations of abuse to the police? Why do they send children back to the arms of their abusers? They'd refuse to talk to us, but here at last, we had our chance.
Tell me about the database. How do you justify keeping a list of people, men in some cases, who have confessed to paedophilia, but you have not reported them to the authority? What justification is there for you to keep that list?
You have a privacy law. You have a directive from the European Union. You observe that, don't you?
So when allegations of abuse are made, it's all right to keep them private?
I think you were answered. That question was answered to your satisfaction.
Can you answer it now?
I'm not going to repeat. I'll just tell you exactly that you can go and you see it in writing. It's all okay. You know, the Bible says, do not go beyond the things that are written. We don't go beyond the things that are written.
But Ted Jarris was a very rigid person. He served as a missionary in Australia and was in the branch office there. And I have received many letters from people in Australia who knew him personally. And they all say what a hard man he was. Mm-hmm. And that was true on the governing body. He had that attitude. Go ahead. I remember one case where Ted Jarris said, well, suppose this ruling does cause some hardship for a few people. He said, we can't be concerned about that. We have to think of this big organization that we have. So that the individual didn't seem to matter. It was the organization that counted.